Danny.
Terry.
You called an audible last night.
That's what I do when I see a blitz coming.
A blitz?
I guess Talur just happened to be on the roof at the exact moment that we were coming out with those diamonds.
How'd you know I'd go for him?
Because you're you and I'm me. We were watching Talur while you had him watching us. This is your end, which you donated to charity.
Charity?
Camp to Belong. The kids are very grateful. They're going to have you up to visit next month.
Now, you know that wasn't our deal.
Well, if you feel that strongly about it, then we'll yank the kids out of the camp and we'll send them back to their foster homes. All 200 of them.
You think this is funny?
Well, Terry, it sure as ain't sad.
Welcome to Franchise Killer, a podcast where we pick movie franchises or wannabe franchises, review them film by film, and see where things went wrong. Or right. I'm Reese, the host. You are?
David.
And you are?
Irina.
And across from me?
Noah.
And you didn't have a name this time?
No.
I was ready for it, because usually you throw me that little curveball, and I'm like...
You queued me up, so therefore I decided no.
Okay.
He's number 13.
It has to be unexpected.
And off in a distant land, we have...
AJ.
And today, we're talking about Ocean's 13. Pause for effect. Everyone saw Ocean's 13, correct?
Well...
Oh, no.
So I actually watched two movies... just so I'd have, you know, twice as many chances to get it right.
You know, you can text me.
Smart.
But
you could text me to make sure.
What happened to this movie? You have to remind me. Was there a swing shot of the spaceship around a moon?
No, don't think
not,
so.
Not quite. No.
And okay, so not that one, but this one has to be like, the girl in this movie.
You're already off. There's like no women in this movie.
There is one. There's a cougar.
Then who aged 17 years after a birthday wish?
Oh.
Are you thinking that's of 13
going on 30?
Yeah.
Wow. That's
what this movie
there
is,
isn't
it?
There you go. That's it.
Wow.
That's one of those actresses I really hate.
Well, I'm sure we can devote a little snippet of time for you to talk about both of those movies, and you can give your little review and then throw it in the recycling or in the trash. Then.
That's it. That's all there is.
So Ocean's 13 is once again directed by Steven Soderbergh. And I guess for any new listeners, I'll run down his filmography once more. But he also directed Sex, Lies, and Videotape, Traffic, Aaron Brockovich, The Ocean's Trilogy, Contagion, Magic Mike, Side Effects, and Logan Lucky. Among many others, he's a very active director, as we've established. The movie stars... George Clooney, Brad Pitt, Matt Damon, Andy Garcia, Don Cheadle, Bernie Mac, Elliot Gould, Casey Affleck, Scott Caan, Eddie Jemison, Shaobo, say it for me guys.
Chin.
Carl Reiner, Eddie Izzard, Al Pacino, Ellen Barkin, and Vincent Castle. There's even others in this movie, but the cast is just, it's a novel of names. Notably absent this time around is both Catherine Zeta-Jones and Julia Roberts. It's not their fight. This is a sausages fight. Only
just a fight. Bunch of sausages fighting.
It's a big old sausage party.
Yes.
Yeah.
And the screenplay is by Brian Koppelman and David Levien, which is different than the last two films. He likes to swap his... the writers up on these movies a lot, so that's kind of surprising. You'd think there'd be some consistency, but I guess I don't know.
Well, I mean, the last movie I'm not so certain was the best writing, so maybe he made a good move on that one.
Yeah, who knows? On this podcast, we first go over our thoughts on the film before revisiting it for the episode. Then we dive into the story, break it down bit by bit, and talk about the more significant moments. Towards the end of the show, we give our brief reviews and numbered scores, along with an analysis on the health of the franchise and whether or not this film hurt it. So, you guys, had y'all seen Ocean's 13 before this episode? Noah?
No. Just the same as the last two movies?
No. You mean you didn't watch this movie and not watch the other two?
Okay, actually, I went back in time before the first episode, and I watched it.
Okay.
Yeah, at that point.
Just so he'd be more knowledgeable for the other ones. Exactly. Retroactively.
Exactly. That makes sense. Irina.
No.
David.
Nope.
All no's across the board. No fun anecdotes about
how we haven't
seen it. I usually do have
one.
Well, after the last one, I mean, what are you going to say? That's true. We kind of outlined it.
Yeah, that's true. How about you, AJ?
So when I first saw the first one, I went through a binge watch of the trilogy, but I don't actually remember if I finished the third one. I think I fell asleep by that time.
So yeah, I think on the last couple of episodes, you said you'd seen all three of them, and I guess you watched this and you're like, I don't remember seeing any of this.
Yeah, a little bit less distinct memories. I mean, some familiarity to it, but didn't stick out in my mind as much as Julia Roberts being Julia Roberts.
Yep.
Yeah. I have also not seen this movie, though there, again, with all of these, there's certain scenes where I'm like, I have seen that scene. And I don't know where, I even could have watched it because we never had cable or anything
See, that's what I was going to say. Maybe it was on the background somewhere.
Yeah, but I've definitely, there's a couple of scenes in this movie that I recognize. But other than that, like, it's a complete blank slate for me.
I do remember the trailers being pushed pretty heavily. I mean, marketing was pretty strong for this.
Yeah. This franchise just, it all kind of runs together for me in terms of the trailers, because I always thought they all looked kind of the same, and I was it was kind of indistinguishable for me.
Yeah.
So I guess I remember the marketing for this movie, but it could have just as easily been for 2 and 1. So yeah.
I would say Ocean's 13 was the one I definitely remember the most marketing wise, and I guess that's because I was older, but I definitely saw the poster up at the movie theater. I remember my parents talking about it a little bit.
Wait, were you working there?
No, not in 2007. Oh. Not yet. Give it 3 years.
Oh. all right. Are y'all ready to get into this story here?
Yes.
Yeah, brother.
All right. Kick it off.
This town might have changed, but not me. I know people. Highly invested in my survival, and they are people who really know how to hurt in ways you can't even imagine.
Well, I know all the guys that you'd hire to come after me. They like me better than you. I know how that makes me feel. I know what that makes me want to do.
I was really hoping to avoid that this time.
Let's go, boys.
He's gonna fall for this?
You did. You ready?
I was born ready.
Ruben Tishkoff invests in building a new premier casino hotel on the Las Vegas Strip. Against the advice of Danny Ocean and others, Ruben involves himself with wealthy investor Willie Bank, who inevitably cheats him out of his share of the deal. As a result of the stress of the betrayal, Tishkoff suffers a heart attack and becomes bedridden. Ocean offers Bank a second chance to set things right, given his long history in Las Vegas, and the fact that he shook Sinatra's hand. But Bank refuses and completes construction of the hotel, renamed The Bank. To avenge Tishkoff, Ocean gathers his partners in crime, who plan to ruin Bank on the hotel's grand opening.
That's a good start.
Yeah.
It is a good start.
Yeah, I definitely think that we're back to form on this one. I think going back to casinos is what they needed to do, I think, to end it.
Yeah, it's a palate cleanse.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's also a good revenge story a little bit.
Yes. I think this movie, they realized kind of the mistake that they made with the second one, or maybe they just weren't prepared enough, and they're like, okay, we loaded our plate up with a few too many things, and now we need to pare it back a little bit to, what is an Ocean's movie, really? Like, what makes those movies tick?
And a casino movie where we rob the wealthy.
Yes. And
but they got to be crooked, too.
I think this one, they went a little more in the direction of that Robin Hood aspect, where it's just like a band of brothers kind of thing and trying to, you know, stick up for their I guess you could call him a bit of a, he's a benefactor, but almost like a fatherly role for some of them in a strange way. I think they tried to develop that connection.
Oh, yeah. So this movie, and not to reveal my hand, it, I always say that, but it might have won me over. Like,
Wait, right off the bat?
Right off the bat, yes. I think, for one, it realizes what I didn't like personally about the first movie and what I didn't like about the second movie, and adjusts both of those things. It fine-tunes the elements that made those movies work.
Yeah.
And it added a certain, as you said, it's that Robin Hood element where I actually care about these guys for once, because you set up a villain that you actually don't like.
Mm-hmm.
And Al Pacino, there's a reason for them to take this guy down that you're like, yes, I want this guy to be taken down. Whereas Andy Garcia's character, or Terry Benedict in the first one, was
questionable.
Yeah, like, you didn't like him. He's kind of a snake.
Actually, I would say, but even in this movie, it made me like his character more.
I know, yeah. I kind of did like him in this one.
Yeah. Now I don't think Al Pacino's, like, or Bank is giving a stellar performance. Like, it seems like he's kind of phoning it in.
I would say it's believable.
Yeah, I felt like he dissolved into this role, or, you know, disappeared into the role. I didn't really see him, oh, that's just Al Pacino being Al Pacino. I thought he was that character.
Yeah. But they united the team around a cause that made sense, because Ruben has the heart attack because of Bank.
Yeah.
So they're there's more of a family element, and they're looking out for each other, which in the other one, it was more of kind of a selfish pursuits.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you have a villain, which those were my main two issues with the first movie.
Yeah, didn't really have a villain that one. It kind of had an antagonist, but it wasn't a real...
Someone you could hate. Know,
yeah.
You didn't feel like, oh, man... These guys needed to rob him.
Yeah.
You know?
This guy, you're just like, oh, yeah. But just to clarify a little bit, Ruben had an investment with Banks. Is that what it was? They were both going to open up this hotel, and then Banks kind of booted him, got him to sign off his name, or he was going to kill him?
Yeah.
Pretty much, yeah.
And which is kind of dumb on his part, because this Bank guy had a reputation for just cutting people off and taking everything.
But they definitely state that in the movie as just, you know, that's who
Ruben
is. And they all knew that he shouldn't have done that.
So I'm going to push back a little on the intro. I felt that while it does make sense, like, I do like that there's a central villain now, and that there's some sort of motive that isn't just we want money or we want this person hit this person's ego to be checked. I don't know, although that's part of it. I didn't really feel much from Ruben having a heart attack. I don't know why, it just didn't really sink in that he was actually in, you know, dire straits or anything. I was just like, bedridden. I don't know, it seems like he's faking it, sort of. I don't really feel much of the camaraderie in this one.
He does kind of just decide to get up and start walking towards the end. They're like, oh, I'm fine. Nothing ever happened.
A lot of the emotion felt kind of lacking or forced in some way. I don't know.
Yeah.
For me, it just didn't seem like it was that strong.
I'll agree with that, but I like it as a means for them to band together.
Yeah.
Like, I like the motivation.
I mean, they get you on board by, you know, bringing you on the side of a generally likable character from the first two movies.
Mm-hmm.
But I think what throws it off is, you know, especially in the first one, they go to him for advice and he's like, no, I know this town. I know, like, don't mess with Terry Benedict. Don't mess with all this. He's always on the cautious side because he knows the ins and outs of it and, you know, where to stick your nose and where not to. So it just kind of seems out of character for him to be naive and trusting Bank.
Yeah, he's
that's true.
You're right. He's kind of dumbed down.
It's kind of, it might actually make sense because of, we did mention there were new writers on board with this movie, so maybe they did struggle trying to kind of, I guess, do these characters justice in a way, or carry on what their personalities were or how they would interact in a way that would seem natural, so that maybe we're picking up on some of that oddness to it. I'm not sure, but it did feel a little strange.
I took it as Ruben still kind of being good-hearted, and, you know, despite pulling heists, and he, you know, obviously is the only one that actually maintains his wealth throughout the movies. He doesn't just spend it all. Like, he still wants to make his money legitimately versus just, you know, stealing it all. So yeah, I think that was like, hey, I want to make my own money legitimately instead of relying on Danny and all these heists and stuff. Like, I want to get back in the game and do it right. And then I think that kind of clouded his judgment a little bit. But
maybe if there was a little more buildup on that discussion or that understanding before all of this tragedy happened, I guess, maybe it would have more of an impact, because you don't, it's kind of just mentioned offhandedly that, oh yeah, you know, we're both kind of cut from the same cloth. We shook Sinatra's hand.
Yeah, like, that was a big point.
He'll treat me differently because we understand each other. And what, but you don't really get that.
What softened the blow of the betrayal too is, like, even though Danny warned Ruben not to go trust him, like, even after the fact, Danny goes and talks to him, you know, being all nice. Like, he's still like, you know, hey, do you want to make this right, please? Like, he's not immediately on guard and already plotting against him. Or I'm sure he is plotting against him, but the fact that he gave him that, that second chance and respect still kind of throws off the stab of the betrayal.
Yeah, that's true. It kind of dulls it a bit.
So there is that point where he brings up, we both shook Sinatra's hand. Is that a thing? Or did they just make that up?
I think it's just a reference to the fact that Sinatra was in Ocean's 11, and they're just kind of calling back
and
to that.
Big into casinos and always there performing or hanging out. And,
okay. Well, when they say, like, well, we both shook Sinatra's hand, everyone knows you don't go back on a deal when you both shake Sinatra's hand.
Yeah. I think there's...
It's just a nod to the original.
Okay, yeah. Okay.
I don't know if any of you have been to Vegas, but, you know, you've got the Bellagio that Terry Benedict ostensibly owns in this, and the Mirage, Mandalay Bay, all these, like, fancy luxury-sounding names. Like, would you walk into a casino called The Bank?
No.
I don't think so.
Well, I mean, just by
it depends
the look,
on how nice it looks.
Well, yeah, the look of it honest. In this movie, I dug the look. Yeah. I liked it.
Anyway, for my, you know, small brain, this more cut and dry, straightforward story is exactly what I was looking for, because I actually think it's so much better than the scatterbrained plot of Ocean's 12.
Mm-hmm.
I like just having a singular motivation and just amping up that revenge slash family element a little bit, because I thought that was what was missing from the first one. So maybe in my unique situation, this movie is really exciting me, because I'm one of the few people that wasn't as jazzed by the first movie. But I could see people who are big fans of the first movie being like, oh yeah, this is like the first movie but not as good. So, you know, to each his own.
They develop a plan with two objectives. The first is to prevent the bank from winning the prestigious Five Diamond Award. Saul Bloom will stand in as the anonymous diamond reviewer, while Ocean and his associates will make the real reviewer's hotel experience terrible. The second objective is to rig all of the casino's games to pay out millions in winnings. While they can implement various rigging mechanisms into the casino, Danny and his crew are up against a cutting-edge anti-cheating system called the Greco Player Tracker. They also obtain a massive drilling machine to simulate an earthquake under the casino, forcing an evacuation of the casino right after paying out massive winnings.
So a little bit of suspension of disbelief going into this movie, but I mean...
Well, I mean, if you weren't disbelieving in the first one with the EMP, then
it's still tracks.
Yeah. It's still goofy, but this one, like, makes you overlook it. It was only when I was going through the plot here in, you know, in written form, I was like, wow, this is just goofy, but I didn't really notice it jump out at me during the movie.
Yeah, they kind of just slip it in there without you having to focus on it too much.
Like, yeah, I'm okay with a little bit of that. Just like, this couldn't happen, but I love it. It's like that scene in Fast Five where Vin Diesel jumps across or like launches himself from a car onto another car.
I wouldn't say it's quite on that level.
Freeway. Well,
how much do we actually
simulating
know?
Simulating an earthquake is pretty impossible.
We have somebody who knows about geology in the room. Can you simulate an earthquake using a giant drill?
Well,
no, he shakes his head. No,
his head.
So they talked about the resonance of the building, which is a real thing. In architecture and, you know, civil engineering, there is a resonance of a building that they do try to compensate for fault zones and earthquake prone areas. So that that kind of tracks a little bit. The giant drill that, you know, dug whatever French canal or whatever, it's kind of goofy, but
yeah
that's kind of
they
what
made
we're
it believable
about.
With but the seismology,
I'm perfectly okay with that.
And it didn't bug me too
not much. Only that, I really enjoy all the plan making and how you're actually watching them kind of the whole time create each of their plans, and you're like, okay, that can work. That doesn't. Maybe some things rely on a bit of chance, but
it made me retroactively want to give the first movie another chance, because I was like, it was playing some of those same notes that I liked about that movie, and it's like, maybe I do like the first one better than I'm letting on. Yeah. And maybe it took that second movie to get me to realize that.
Yeah.
But it's like, yeah, I definitely don't like 12. Mm. Maybe I do like Ocean's 11, and it, you know.
Well, I will say the first one does kind of come up a little more dry, in my opinion, than this one did. This one just has some sort of flavor to it that
I feel like
is more appealing.
We treat the first one as if it's a more recent film than it actually is. At least that's how I looked back on it. I was like, you know, that film was, what, 2001?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I review it, you know, kind of with the reputation that it has, just kind of treating it as it's a recent film when it's really,
it's because it has that. Yeah, and we've talked about how it has kind of that timeless quality, except for a couple of like early 2000s tropes.
Yeah.
But yeah, that movie, for the most part, stands the test of time, and that's why we are able to hold it to today's standard.
Well, also, I think they balanced all the actors the best in this one, too.
Yeah, I was just about to bring up awesome big cast in this, just like the other couple of movies. How do we think they're treated in this movie?
I actually like what's his name? Eddie Izzard's character, Roman. I like his heightened role in this. I thought that was refreshing.
Yeah, I like how he's more involved in this one. Board. He's also the one that kind of helps up the, you know, the tension for how hard of a job this is for them. He's been flown out there, and when they tell them what they're up to doing, he's ready to just give them their money back and leave because it's impossible. And that's getting through the Greco security system,
I guess.
He kind of
plays the hype man in this one. It's just the, all right, let's hype this up, make it a little more
up
exciting,
the stakes. Yeah.
Up the ante a little bit.
Yeah, definitely.
Do you think any of the cast members fare better or worse in this movie than any of the previous ones?
I do think that the, what's his name? Chinese Mandarin speaking.
Amazing
Yen. Yes, Yen. Amazing Yen. I don't really know why he's there. He's kind of in it, but
he's
don't...
He's in that elevator sequence to...
Yeah, but it still feels like he's sort of... There are some of them that they pop up on the screen, and I forget that they were part of the team.
Burning
Mac. Oh, wait. Oh, yeah. You're in this. So.
Honestly, I think it's because he doesn't really have anything memorable that he does or says because he doesn't ever speak English or
I will say in this one, even more people are around him while he's speaking Mandarin, and they all kind of react to him. So it's
like a Chewy effect.
Yeah,
like
it's a running
people
joke.
Just know what he's saying. Mm.
It's a running joke from like the first two in a way, but it was more funny by the third movie. I was like, all right, everyone just speaks Mandarin. I get it. I love it.
I think in the case of this movie, it was a wise decision to pare back subtitle card characters.
Yeah.
And devote more attention to Linus, Rusty, and Danny. Because I feel like their characters are enhanced a little bit in this movie. And whereas all the other ones, I kind of forget that some of them are there. I think it is paying more attention to the most important characters in this story. So
yeah,
I would say Basher has a pretty decent amount of screen time on this one.
Yeah.
That was actually effective compared to the second one.
Yeah,
so
he does.
Who noticed that Don Cheadle didn't sound quite as bad as the other two
He's
movies.
He's phasing it out.
I don't know. It still sounded pretty bad.
Both movies they allude to is terrible accent, so it's kind of an in-joke by this point.
Yeah,
it wasn't as gratuitous in this one.
Honestly, it's one of those things where it's too late for them to go back on it now, so all they have to do is poke fun at themselves, and I do think that's kind of funny.
I didn't really understand fully the Mormon brothers... I know they were involved in the factory, but that whole wage walkout thing was it threw things off
just
a little bit, but I don't know if that was just supposed to add lightheartedness to the movie.
Yeah, I think it was just that. I think it was just to add lightheartedness because, if I recall, the team was kind of annoyed with them for starting that whole thing because they needed the factory to be up and running, but they started like some sort of revolution.
More of like a, sit out of work, until we get paid more.
Yeah. I guess it's kind of them speaking vicariously through the other workers that they feel like they get the short end of the stick on the team, too.
Yeah, could be.
That's possible, yeah.
I was a little confused on that segment
it was,
as well.
It was a little weird.
But it's I do kind of like the concept that to try and pull this off, you have to go big and go to the roots in order to even pull this off. Because so I kind of liked being able to see that aspect where, oh, wow, they went all the way back to the plastic factory.
Yeah, they're manufacturing the base materials.
Manufacture the dice. Yeah, so I'm like that. I think that's an interesting thing to do, because otherwise they could have just kind of jumped the shark and figured out some weird way to circumvent things or on like location.
Or like they usually do where they show it in a flashback, like, oh yeah, we totally did that at that point. And just show a little brief, like 2 second thing of them like
We swapped them at the factory back when.
When they're doing, so the plan is to rig multiple different games, right? So this dice scene, or I guess, is it one game that they're using this dice for? Or is it for multiple?
Multiple.
It's multiple?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, and the whole thing is that they put, I didn't quite get it. Did they put some sort of metallic thing into the manufacturing of the dice that allows them to control them? Like, how does that work?
It seemed magnetized.
Yeah, it was specifically not metallic, because each table at these high-end casinos have, you know, devices that detect interference and stuff like that. So it's, it's ostensibly the technology in this is non-metallic, so it doesn't pick up on the sensors, but they can still blast it with some kind of radio frequency with their little clickers, the Zippos, to make it land however they want to.
Yeah.
So yeah, that was a little bit of a MacGuffin, but I mean, at this point,
it's a forgivable one.
Yeah. But yeah, they also loaded the balls and the slot machine and all that.
Yeah. And the Samsung phone with the magnetron in it.
Yeah.
That too. Yeah.
Gotta love that.
Oh gosh.
How far are we in this right now?
So, I want to talk about. Are we at the point when Rusty puts on that ridiculous disguise and brings the...
Oh, the seismologist?
Yeah, the seismologist. Yeah.
I believe we passed that, yeah.
This is one of the two ridiculous disguises in this movie that I find kind of hilarious. Like, I can't tell if I love or hate them, but it's just like, oh, they're going for it.
This one I liked. I think there were some other ones I wasn't a fan of, but that one specifically I liked.
The big... All three of them have their own unique... disguise. Like Danny had the mustache.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
So apparently that was a call out to Freddie Mercury.
Yeah.
Like the look of it.
So a lot of the David and I were watching something where a lot of the disguises were based off of actual people. It was Freddie Mercury, and then the seismologist was based off a guitarist of some kind. What was his name?
Band.
I can't remember his name, but it looked identical. So a lot of weird little factoids in this.
Linus was Brothers Grimm, right? Like they wanted his character to wear like a big nose or something.
Yeah.
I love that. I love that big old nose.
But I did want to poke a little hole in this real quick. I feel like if Al Pacino had done any like seismic research or consulted anyone at all, he could have figured out that there was something sketchy about what Rusty was doing.
That is literally what I was saying when I was watching this with Irene. I was like, literally all he has to do is call his local college and be like, hey, is there an earthquake coming?
No, but let's put this big hulking thing that looks kind of like a bomb in my office.
Not to mention, that looked quite expensive.
It did.
You know, if this kind of technology can do that, it would be expensive, and this guy's just going to drop it there for you.
I guess it's because he didn't believe them at all anyways. I got whatever, and just left it.
The movie's kind of pushing a little bit of what is actually believable, but, you know, we're meant to go with it. Yeah. And again, this is coming off
along
of 12.
With the story.
Yeah.
Let's move on. Shortly before opening night, the drill breaks down, forcing Danny to ask prior rival and former heist target Terry Benedict for funds to buy a replacement. Benedict, who also seeks advantage over Bank, offers the funds for a portion of the share of his take and demands that Ocean also steals Bank's private diamond collection in celebration of his 5 diamond awards. These are valued at over $250 million and secured in a case at the top of the bank. Ocean has Linus Caldwell get romantically close to Bank's assistant, Abigail Sponder, to gain access to the case. So upping the stakes even more, upping the ante. We've got Terry Benedict in on the job now, but he wants them to get the 5 diamonds.
5 diamonds.
I thought this was, again, another cool kind of plot twist or adjustment where it's like, oh, it's the stakes are raised
now. Have to do this.
Yeah, I paused the movie at this point because I didn't know how I felt about Terry Benedict getting roped in. I was like, okay, would this be reasonable.
Really?
Because after the first two movies of them kind of like working against him, I was like, why would he trust them? But they kind of tied together.
Whenever I saw him show up as the guy, I was like, oh, yeah. Yes.
I mean, I like it.
I was excited.
It makes sense because the second movie was all about them evening the scales.
Well, like, also, I like him just having more of a role in their team. Yeah. I kind of like that idea.
In that moment where he was getting all giddy at the fact that the guy was going to suffer, I was like, yeah, you know now.
So I guess what I was wondering is, regardless of what happened, they're not trustworthy people, really. So what is his vested interest in this? And they did make sense with it by saying that the bank hotel is right in front of his hotel and casting a shadow on his pool kind of thing, where it's like, I don't want this kind of competition. That made sense to me. And I was like, okay, so he knows they can do the job and he doesn't like this guy. He's like, screw it, go for it. You know, just give me the diamonds.
Makes sense.
Yeah. I like it.
Yeah.
I like
and this movie is
the little like arrogant tongue in cheek of it's casting a shadow on my pool. The pool being the Fountains of the Bellagio, which is like one of the biggest attractions in Vegas.
Yep.
Which has some symbolism in the first and second movie or third movies as well. So.
Oh yeah.
And
this is
like this franchise or this movie, it's finally hit my sweet spot where it's like, okay, this is cooking and I'm enjoying it. I'm lapping it up. For me, this is the defining Ocean's movie, and I know no one else shares that opinion.
Really?
No one?
What?
Well, I feel like no one says Ocean's 13
is the best. No, nothing.
Reese, okay. I actually agree with you. In both of the other movies, I can say I was entertained and I was watching them the whole time. I was like, oh, I like that. Or, well, that wasn't as great, but it's enjoyable. Mm-hmm. But this one actually had me, you know, smiling as I was watching it.
Yeah.
So I think that's kind of a big thing as far as movies go. Like,
And the sec, the Ocean's 12 wasn't a disaster. I just think they overcorrected and made it too goofy because the first one was, in my opinion, a little dry. And this one, it balances it. It's like, okay, we'll keep some of that goofy charm that was in 12, but it's not ever going to get to like Spider-Man 3 ridiculous dance laser sequence.
dance laser sequence.
Yeah.
So just to get back to the Terry Benedict thing, just so I can clarify for myself a little bit, why did they need him again? I know they needed him for money of some sort, but why?
It was for the drill, because they couldn't repair it or make a new one or anything. He was the only one with
but
the money.
But he's wondering why they didn't have money. Is that what you're saying?
Oh, I mean, I guess they had money from before, but I guess the drill just cost way too much money.
Yeah, well, it was just too expensive of a product.
Ruben was the one that was always bankrolling them before and, you know, catching them in whatever excess they needed. Whenever they ran over budget, Ruben took care of it, and obviously Ruben's out of commission here, so they have to go somewhere else.
Okay. Right.
Yeah.
And it makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought it
kind of fills that role.
Yeah, there. I mean, I went along with it, and I liked it. I just wanted to make sure I knew 100% why. Yeah.
Hey, it helps in case viewers
props to Andy Garcia's performance, because it really, he of anyone shows the difference in the writing, and, you know, I think he really acts to the writing. And his performance, his character is pretty different in all three movies. And he did a great job as he was written in, especially the first and third. But I really enjoyed him in this movie.
Yeah. I don't know what it is about him, but every time I see him, he just kind of makes me happy.
I know.
Even when he's playing a bad guy, I'm just like, oh, look, Andy Garcia.
He's got some you're just glad to see him there.
Yeah. Everything he does is so understated, too. Yeah. So something about him.
There's some kind of like twinkle in his eye there that you're like, there's a personality in that face.
I learned that some of the scenes that he had in this movie were recorded without him knowing what was going on, and they just kind of like had him do different reactions.
Oh yeah, that's later on when he's watching.
Was it just that one part?
Yeah,
okay. I thought it was like most of the.
Yeah, he's watching vicariously through
or the
camera
recording of Linus walking through the streets of New York or London when he was filming the Bourne movies, and he's kind of dropping a little hint of the plot of the Bourne movie.
Yeah, well, I thought about that. It was the shaky cam.
They added in the tones and the camera style of it, and I think he even says something.
I think
that
I'm
kind
being followed. He says,
"Yeah. I don't know quite what my name is." Like,
you're Bourne.
Speaking of Linus, I think this was the best his character's been of the three movies.
Yes,
I think we can all agree on that one.
Another example of not being too goofy, but still keeping some of that funny charm that he had.
Exactly.
And also that, you know, sense of being the younger brother where...
Yeah, even, but he's coming into his own.
Exactly. They yeah. still kind of call him out. He's still like, come on, I know what I'm doing.
Yeah, and he even has that the nose plan, which is his.
I so. Love it.
I actually really like the moment where he gives that letter to Ruben and he's like, gets halfway through it and he's yes. just like, I'll just leave you to read this.
Well, we see him coming to his own, like you said, where the first movie he's like, you know, kind of shaky. He's like, yeah, I guess I'll step in for Danny. And then the mm-hmm. second movie, he's like, can I be involved and just still being nervous about it? And then we have the whole Lost in Translation thing that throws him off. Here he's like demanding, yeah. no, I can do this. So it kind of yeah. has yeah. that progression.
And they're like, it's okay. Cool. Like, and they completely trust him to do it. So I really like his kind of character arc. In yeah. this one, he, you know, went full circle. He's doing all the stuff pretty
doing
flawlessly.
All the stuff.
That whole cougar scene was a little weird, but it was enjoyable nonetheless.
Are we to the cougar scene?
Yeah, yeah. We,
yeah.
The nose.
The Gilroy. The whole pheromone thing.
Yeah, that was weird. That
was
almost,
a little weird.
That almost pushed it a little too far. That's
like,
the one moment.
Yeah,
she legitimately seemed drugged.
That was a... yeah.
This,
that was,
I think that could have been as easily fixed by just... somehow charming her and getting her to drink a little more than she needed to. I don't think the whole Gilroy thing was necessary, but yeah. no, whatever. It's
so
fine.
Was the whole thing just to throw off Tallulah from...
No, the, so no, they were stealing the diamonds. Go up to the top to get the diamonds.
No, well, no, but
the thing that was to throw off Tallulah was the extra set of diamonds he had as like
well,
a
Well, the thing is, he
girdle.
Never stole the diamonds in there. He still had the fakes on him, and yeah. they... took the whole building later.
No, remember he was setting up those things with the red lights.
Oh,
on
that's
there?
What. Well, yeah. What were those?
Those were little kind of bomb type things that were going to explode the ground. Around
okay,
it
so that's
it
what it was. Yeah,
also
to
safer or whatever. Could
keep
be
her away. And this character's name is Abigail Sponder, by the way, for listeners.
Yeah.
Played by mm-hmm. Ellen Barkin, I think. Yes. It's to keep her away from Bank while Basher is impersonating the Evel Knievel type character.
That's right.
Where there's that other assistant that just lets him barge through, Abigail probably would have caught that and headed him off.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you got the two components.
Yeah, yeah.
That.
I mean, there's so much going on that sometimes I miss some of the subtlety that they do. I know the second one made me feel stupid for not catching half the stuff. And then this one, I kind of went in half-cocked thinking that they're just going to be trying to throw me off at all the time. You know,
yeah.
like
yeah.
maybe that whole thing with Matt Damon's character where he's trying to throw off the cougar may have been some sort of joke on him again. I was kind of half thinking they were going to do that to him again.
I will say, I don't think you'd get away with a scene like that.
Oh, definitely
in today's
not.
Climate.
And I
basically
feel like
Rohypnol
maybe.
In patch form.
Yeah, it's a bit date rapey.
Or they shouldn't have got away with it either. That said, if you ignore that,
if you just take it as a movie that's not trying to, you know,
yeah, I don't think they meant it that way. It just,
yeah, it's a little icky.
In hindsight,
it's a little icky
in poor taste.
Yeah, because pheromones make you act like you're just drugged up and horny.
I don't think it was the pheromones though. I think it was his nose.
Oh, she was just so.
I think it was
into
his
that.
Nose.
She was so shocked when his nose was ripped off later.
What I love
like,
is,
oh,
I just love how. Obviously fake it
thing
is.
About you.
Oh, I know.
This is really hooked. No,
especially
yeah.
when he like turns and you get the full side profile. It's
you're
like
whoa.
You're like, that well, nose.
They show
I mean,
him
to
trying
be fair,
to...
I've seen some guys.
Well, they show him trying to drink some wine with the nose. Did you see
oh,
that?
Yeah.
He's like,
yeah.
oh, crap, how do I do this?
I think they're going to... It would have been funny if they tried to kiss and like the
he
nose
He was just
stops.
Having a little...
She's
yeah.
like, oh my goodness, I love
that
nose.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. Let's not think about it.
Yeah. It doesn't.
It's not worth it.
More effort than that.
So what do y'all think about the heist in this movie and how it kind of compares to the ones in the other movies? Do you? Yeah.
This one was simpler, I think, other than the, you know, the seismology thing.
I don't even know if it was simpler. It was just, it just made more sense.
Or easier to understand,
yeah,
maybe.
Yeah, it was easier to understand.
In the end, all
sure.
they're trying to do is set up rigged games. Like,
yeah.
in the end, that's what the end goal is.
I feel like this one relied a lot more on chance, luck, and assumptions on things working the way they would work, whereas the first
yeah.
one relied a lot more on talent and skill and expertise.
Yeah.
And the second one relied on you thinking another woman was actually Julia Roberts and that Bruce Willis wouldn't
oh,
recognize her.
Let's just ignore this.
I think
ignore Ocean's 12.
The aspect I did enjoy about this, though, was I like the psychological effect that it has as far as them trying to play with Bank's ego, you know, and kind of just dropping the five diamond award thing accidentally by Saul to, mm-hmm. you know, like let Abigail know that, oh, this is the guy who's going to be reviewing the hotel, knowing that that would lead to a chain of events where he's hyper-focused on this one guest and avoiding everything else. Mm-hmm. And then just kind of their weak spot is their ego.
Yeah.
And I really enjoy that because it's almost, to me, kind of going back to our talks about magic tricks where, mm-hmm. like, they have a blind spot. Everyone has a blind spot that they don't think about. And so I enjoyed seeing that aspect used against him. So mm-hmm. despite all of the gadgets that he has to keep from theft or, you know, rigging the system, he still has his own, like, personal issues that caused this to happen.
So especially the scene where they're trying to convince him to buy this specific game for his casino. Nuff said. Where Bernie Mac has his, like, 2 minutes of showtime.
I honestly, like, enjoyed seeing Bernie Mac in this a little more than the other two. He had almost virtually no role in the first two films. So I liked seeing him in this a little more and kind of playing the salesman pitch.
He's good at it.
He's pretty good at it.
And that was also kind of ties in at that moment to what you're saying about playing his ego, because that's where Benedict came in and mm-hmm. played his part, mm-hmm. where he's like, no, I'll buy that for my casino, which forced
an obvious rival.
Forced Bank to want to take it from him.
So something I liked about Andy Garcia's role in this was watching him in front of the mirror, just kind of going over his line before he went, kind of like, oh, I've never done this before. I'm kind of excited. This is my big night. To be part of a heist, you know?
I'm on the right side of it.
I don't know.
He seemed kind of giddy, and I sort of liked him.
Even though he had an ulterior motive at the end.
Yeah.
So we didn't talk about how they duped the reviewer and put him in a different room.
I know. I felt so bad for that guy.
I forgot that actor's name, and I feel terrible, but he's in a lot of stuff. He's always like, oh, it's that guy.
Yeah. I've seen him before, but I can't place where.
It was kind of a fun little David Paymer.
Thanks.
Hey, there we go.
It's kind of a fun little subplot seeing him, you know, get run into misfortune after misfortune that they've set him up with.
Yeah.
And they even wrap that up in the end in a satisfying way.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
On opening night, Ocean institutes the final part of the plan by having FBI agents on his payroll arrive at the hotel and arrest Livingston Dell on suspicion of rigging the card shuffling machines, allowing them to be replaced with actual rigged ones. Another FBI agent arrests Linus for switching the diamonds with fakes. The agent takes Linus away but reveals himself to be his father, Robert Caldwell. They try to evacuate from the roof but are intercepted by the Night Fox, who takes the diamonds at gunpoint and parachutes off the roof. However, Ocean anticipated this, and Tellur ends up with fakes. Linus and his father escape in a helicopter piloted by Basher, tearing the case from the roof and taking the real diamonds with them.
All right.
So we didn't quite get to it, but we kind of talked about it,
We didn't fully talk about it. We kind of mentioned it, but
all the pieces come together in a very satisfying way for me.
Oh yeah. Mm-hmm.
In this conclusion, the heist seems satisfying. The final interaction between Bank and Danny just hit the right chord for me.
Mm-hmm.
I even love Tellur coming in there.
Yeah, just showing up for a minute.
For 1 second and then just getting, you know,
destroyed.
The wool pulled over his eyes once more.
Yeah.
realizing he's duped
again. Well, pays off the teaser
again
from the second movie as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It's not a plausible, you know, situation. There's a lot of, you know, plot holes that I don't know if this heist could actually be pulled off, but from a cinematic standpoint and just as a conclusion to a film, I'm very satisfied and entertained with mm-hmm. How this movie ended.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, me too.
So
okay.
So we finally bring in Linus's father, who's kind of alluded to before, you know, he's got this reputation that precedes him. Early in the movie, we see him, but he just answers the phone as saying extension 723, whatever, instead of saying his name. So they still bring that element that they tried in the second movie of conning the audience.
Right.
And they incorporate that into the heist movie in the third one. And it pays off a little bit better than in the second one.
Yeah, this time it made a lot more sense than in 12 with the FBI coming in, because you saw him already making a scene with what's his name with the machines that were being rigged.
Livingston gets arrested, I'm like, what's going on? And are they actually you know, in trouble? And they even have dialogue saying, okay, if this happens, we're in trouble, all that stuff. So the audience is still kind of in suspense about, are they in trouble, or is this? I said trouble like 5 times in a row.
So, are they in trouble?
Trouble.
Yeah, but they're still going for that con on the audience as well that adds that
right.
element.
But it brings it home a lot better than some random Southern mom appearing in Europe and, bringing him back.
I did enjoy watching Don Cheadle have to, jump from one accent to another really ridiculous accent. Just to buy time.
Oh, and yeah.
Just seeing him do that, it was I know we mentioned it before, but this is sort of that poking at themselves for already having a pretty horrible take on a British accent. Yeah. So
I like him as the biker dude a lot more than I liked him as himself.
Yeah.
And that hair. Bikes, that heavy hair, bikes. Man.
I know.
So he has a Southern accent in that one, right? Like he's playing some sort of
the American flag grill.
Yep.
Evil Knievel style, baby.
Yet again, reminding me of Psych with Gus.
Oh, yeah, that's right. One of my negatives about this movie, though, is I don't really understand why Tulor is here. I like the idea of him being in this movie, but I don't get it. I know that he's doing recon on the Benedict guy and then kind of, maybe a little butthurt about being duped before and trying to get back.
I honestly think you have the very end of 12 to thank for that, because there's that scene where he's like looking from afar in at them. Like, I'll get you back.
And they had to bring it home in this one because they...
No, it's not that. It's just a little... They didn't tie it in as well.
No, I know. Probably because they didn't want to.
When I saw him show up, I was thinking, oh, is he going to ruin their plans? Mm-hmm. Are they going to have to figure something else out around him? But then nothing happened. He shows up with a gun saying, give me the diamonds. So he didn't actually do anything really thief-like. He was just kind of like, thanks for stealing the diamonds for me.
Andy Garcia had... Terry Benedict had him under his payroll and was like, hey, I've got some information. You go do this, you'll get a cut.
Yeah.
They were already, Danny Ocean's team were already stealing the diamonds legitimately in agreement with giving Benedict the diamonds, because they're all about their oaths and honor and rules and whatever.
That was
So he was already going to get the diamonds, so why steal them from himself?
Maybe I need to rewind and watch it again, but I think... Terry never specifically said that he wanted them to give him the diamonds. Yeah. It was more just like, I want you to steal them.
I remember he said, you can do what you want with them.
Yeah, he did.
But just take them.
But he should have, at that point, he could have just negotiated, get me the diamonds.
Yeah,
that's
but I just don't understand. Yeah, I didn't quite understand why that was happening. I did like the idea of them tricking Tulor, but I didn't get to, I don't know, that payoff wasn't as big for me.
Maybe it's just an excuse to make sense. It's just an excuse to get Vincent Castle in the movie.
Yeah, I guess. But,
Which is,
Well, so they could have done something a lot better. Yeah.
The rest of the plot makes sense up until that point where I'm just kind of confused as to why that even happened that way. And for them to be upset with Terry Benedict for getting someone else to steal diamonds he already asked for... didn't really feel like a betrayal. If I were Danny Ocean, I would just be like, are out more money just to, prove that you can get the diamonds yourself. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
I think the problem was they didn't quite have enough dudes and they needed one more.
Okay.
So
one more dude in this movie.
I actually think I know why.
Well, who are the 13?
They
who
decided
counts
to
the
have
13?
Him say that.
Yeah, I want to know what the 13 is.
Oh, that was a random question. I was going to ask, are you okay with the con that I was describing, the audience being con, the twist of the FBI being in on it? Because I
have
a little issues. I mean, it worked, but I do take issue with portions of it that we criticized Now You See Me for.
Yeah.
Where they lie to you, basically lie to you the whole way. And then at the end, it's like, oh, gotcha. And it contradicts what you were told. because they outright told you otherwise in the movie. I feel like that happened a little bit in this, in that scene on the casino floor where they're like, oh, the FBI's here. Like, he's going to get arrested and we're going to all get pinched and all this stuff. And then why would they have that conversation if they were, you know, in cahoots with them? Like that conversation was only there to trick the audience, and it just feels disingenuous.
Oh, that's fair. Yeah. I didn't even remember.
And
that
why does this movie? This is the second time this franchise has done it, because they did it with Linus, his mom.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. That's
in
right.
the was that 12?
Yeah. I was just about to make that point.
It's like they did that same trick again. Whereas, okay, that's something you did.
Yeah.
But your parents are in the FBI.
Yeah. I did feel a little similarly about that. So
like they could still have a twist without trying to like outright trick the audience, because that just feels like you lied to me during the movie. Like I enjoy a twist, don't get me wrong, but if you tell me one thing is this way and you tell me later that it's not, then it's just like, well, that breaks continuity.
I actually wholly agree with that. I think this is a little bit less of an offender than Now You See Me was, but I agree there is a bit of that in there.
But I think it's only fair to take issue with it, since we took issue with it elsewhere.
I agree. I didn't even remember the scene in this one, but now that you mentioned it.
And, one issue I have, Ruben coming back, just full health again and back in the mission, I thought was kind of problematic. I get that thematically it's like this fist pump moment.
Yeah.
But I was still like, oh, you're just totally good to go.
Well, yeah. I didn't really feel like it was a big comeback. It was just, oh, he decided to get out of bed today.
Yeah. Like, more emotional issues than the, you know, physical with the heart.
Yeah.
And he was just dejected, I guess, still stunned by the betrayal, and Basher's letters are what got him up and at him.
My impression was that he was bedridden because of a wounded pride, I guess.
Yeah.
Like he was betrayed, so now he's just not talking to people and in this sort of just out of it state where it wasn't necessarily, like, maybe it was partly health, but some of it was just his mental game at that point.
Not to downplay heart attacks. Possible. I mean, they do, you know, knock you out, and then obviously the operation, surgery afterwards, bypass surgery, all that stuff. There's recovery for that, and it's significant. But I think they were going for that heartwarming approach, and it kind of half landed for me. But still, like Irina said, it just you don't get the full impact of it like you should.
For me, it was like better something than nothing, which I didn't think there was any remotely heartwarming aspect about either of the previous two films.
I can get on board with that.
Okay.
Mm. Yeah. The remainder of Ocean's plan goes as expected. As they trigger the earthquake, the players evacuate with millions of dollars of winnings. Ocean approaches a devastated Bank and tells him they did everything. Ocean also reminds Bank that he cannot get revenge, since he cannot go to the police due to Bank's past legal activities, and any men he hires to get revenge illegally would prefer Ocean over Bank. With their share of the winnings, Ocean's crew buys property on the strip for Ruben to build his own casino. As punishment for his betrayal, Ocean donates Benedict's $72 million portion of the take to charity in Benedict's name, forcing him to embarrassingly explain his irregular donation on television. As Ocean, Rusty, and Linus prepare to depart for the airport, Rusty rigs one of the slot machines there to allow the real diamond reviewer to win $11 million, compensating him for how they treated him.
So
I thought that was a nice touch at the end.
Yeah,
I agree. Was one of those scenes that actually did land for me, even though I don't think the betrayal was really that huge a deal. I still really enjoyed how they got back at Terry.
Oh yeah.
For a betrayal. Like, maybe if it was something a little more serious, it would have been even more satisfying, but I loved the way that scenario played out.
Yeah. And I'm ultimately not upset with Terry, because he was just getting the diamonds. The rest of the stuff was the revenge element. He was going to let them have that, but I do like that they still stuck it to him.
Yeah.
I was like, no, we're on to you. We're one step ahead always. Don't even try.
And they stuck kinda, it. Sorry, go ahead.
It kind of mended that issue I had with the second one of them kind of being his dogs.
And yeah.
What are they doing?
You owe me money.
No,
plus interest.
Soderbergh crafted the most satisfying ending you could get for one of these. I think.
Between the three?
No, the three, of course. I don't think it's flawless. The main flaw I find with it is the cop-out of why Bank wouldn't retaliate. It's like, you won't go to the police because reasons, and you know, you can try to pace people to do something against us, but they like me better because I'm nicer. Even though a major theme in all of these movies has been, if you grease enough palms, you can get anything done. Money speaks volumes.
I don't know if Banks. I mean, he kind of acts like he gets the best of Bank, but in the end, we don't actually know what happens after this. We don't know if he did come after him. I think because they knew this is going to be one of the last ones, that they kind of wanted to put a bow on it and make it seem like Ocean is ahead of him.
Yeah.
But who knows what actually
happens. It just felt like an afterthought. Like, I know that you have to, like, put some finality to it. It's just the way they, just like, oh, you know, you're not going to do this because, you know, we're better. Like, it just
it's a kind of convenient reason.
Yeah, it just was a little sloppy, in my opinion.
Yeah. They do set up right from the start, though, that Banks is known to be very untrustworthy, and Ruben should have known better not to trust that. That's also it would work out.
Well, not to mention that Bank has so many employees that are so easily swayed to sabotage their own hotel/casino just to get some extra money. So that must speak to the fact that he's not a great employer. Mm-hmm. So maybe he just, given the opportunity, a lot of people would probably want to stab him in the back. You could, I guess, assume that. And to me, Danny's comment at the end just kind of comes across more as a bluff than actually him being serious.
Yeah.
Just kind of like, you won't go to the police because, you know, you've done bad things. I can't name them all, but I'm sure you have. And, you know, the people you know just like me better. And so just kind of leaving it at that is more of a, like, he's pushing the confidence card so that, kind of to bluff him into thinking he's more well-connected than
and,
he is.
And you buy it from a popcorn movie standpoint, where it's like, he stuck it to him. I'm chomping my popcorn last night. Yeah, you got Bank. And you got Tallulah. You got them all.
And, you know.
You got them all.
You got them all. And the fact that they donated Benedict's money to charity.
I think that was one of my favorite
parts of the movie and one of my favorite quotes. My favorite quote where he's like, what, you think this is funny? He goes, well, it sure ain't sad. Yeah. I thought that was my favorite line of the movie.
That was
I love Andy Garcia's portrayal of, like, well, his delivery, basically, when he's like, well, yeah, all you need to do is, like, look in the child's eyes and, you know, just, you know, you feel
he's just
it.
Floundering on Oprah.
It's like when you see them, when you look in their eyes, you know.
Did you get the impression that maybe he was actually starting to be glad that they had made him do that donation?
Because
now he's got his public presence.
He took a negative and made it a positive.
In a weird way, they did him a favor. That's a big publicity stunt.
Yeah.
And then the ending with the Susan B. Anthony, that was really good in the airport.
Yeah.
With the VOD winning the $11 million in the SWATs.
Yes.
They didn't have to do that.
And that's what I like that they did.
They made him suffer. So they're like, all right, let's make it even.
Otherwise, you'd look back and go, huh, that guy got tortured all movie and they didn't do anything. But in the end, they give him $11 million.
Totally juxtaposes the first movie where they were literally setting bombs to get Basher out to work on it. They've literally shifted into, as we've said, the Robin Hoods.
Yeah. Yes. Oh, they definitely did.
Yeah. They're making sure everyone is taken care of.
Because they gave all the one that had to suffer.
Yeah.
For the gambling, they gave all that money to the people that won it. So that. And then in addition to that, they did take their own cut, but then they helped out the guy that they had hurt before, and
there's more people involved than just them.
Yeah, they sent the money that was Terry Benedict's to the kids. It's definitely Robin Hood.
It all comes out.
Yeah, take from the rich, give to the poor, for sure.
Yeah.
So, do we have any final thoughts on this story before we go into the review portion?
Enough said.
Yeah.
All right. We're gonna take a quick break, and on the other end, we're gonna get into our brief reviews. Talk some box office, and then talk about this franchise. Welcome back. We're here to talk about
Ocean's 13.
Yeah. David, You have our reviews in a little bowl there. You want to?
Oh yeah, I sure do. Pull them? Yeah, there they are.
As I pass them over.
where did they
Dave,
go?
You got them.
All right, so let's go with the first score here. Reese with an 8.
Yes, so massive surge in the ratings for me in this for this particular film. I believe I gave the first one a 6.5 and the second one a 5. This one's hands down my favorite Ocean's movie. That said, I do want to revisit the first one just to give it another shake because I feel like maybe there's more there that I missed. But this movie pulls the elements from the first that I liked and the elements from the second that I liked and blends them into a cohesive whole that I find to be the most satisfying cocktail that Soderbergh has thus made. The first one I found to be a bit dry and the characters were not as well developed for my tastes. I know it's a huge cast and a huge heist movie, but and then the second one, just too goofy. There's some, it just goes, it course corrects or overcorrects in the other direction. And this one, you know, reels it back a little, realizes that Oceans is all about that kind of casino heist feel. And so it brings it back to a familiar setting. And the characters have actually grown over two films. Even though it's still a massive cast, I've gotten to know them a little bit more, and I feel like, oh, I'm actually kind of starting to warm up to some of these characters in this movie. And for that alone, it's instantly better than the previous ones. And I also feel like how they established the villain, and they kind of gave this movie more heart, and there's more of a unity of the team that feels palpable. It just really hit home for me, and the heist is really fun, editing is great, and I forgot to mention this in our rundown, but I think the cinematography is the best in this one. The use of color and the framing of everything, it's a beautiful movie to look at. So overall, I mean, it still has like ridiculous moments that I think kind of drag it down a little bit. There's a few moments that kind of strain belief, but I had a much better time with this one than I did the other two. And I can tell you, I was pushing this viewing of this movie to the very end.
You where sure
I was
like, did.
This is the longest I've waited to watch a movie before the episode because I really have not been feeling the Oceans series. And I was just very pleasantly surprised that I'm like, wow, this one actually like really brought it back for me. And
you feel that ocean breeze now?
Yeah, it maybe retroactively makes me like the first one better. So not the second one, but the first one. So it's one of the few ones so far that we've covered that I'm like, okay, maybe I need to revisit one of the other ones in this franchise to make sure I gave it a, you know, a fair judgment.
Yeah.
But yeah, I stand by that 8.
All right. Dog. Next up, Noah with an 8.
Yeah. Right. Yet again, we're matching.
Yep.
Yeah, I think we matched on the first one as well.
And the second one.
And the second one. Yeah. Wow.
Yep, you guys are just neck and neck.
That is funny. But But yeah, I really enjoyed this one. I thought it was a really fun. It made sense. The cinematography, like you said, was a little better than the other ones. I think all the characters got better screen time than they did before. I mean, sure, some of them still might not have got as much as, you know, the leading actors in this, but I thought it was better than both 1 and 2. Linus was a little more subdued, but also better in his character. I thought the heist made a lot more sense. I mean, it was more enjoyable at least, and each of their arcs completed. So I thought it was just overall a really fun and satisfying movie. Mm-hmm. So I'll leave it at that.
All right.
All right.
Next up is Irina with a 7.
Ooh, she goes down.
What? I don't know. I watched this movie 2.5 times before this review, and it just, overall, I enjoyed it, but a lot of it is kind of forgettable to me. I think a month from now, I'm not really going to remember a lot of what happened. Maybe it's partly because Ocean's 12 just feels like an oversaturation of characters and their personalities to the point that when I watched this, they felt more like shells of that. So maybe I'm just going to say I can watch it again sometime later and maybe it will appeal to me more. But I didn't really feel much from this movie, but I still enjoyed it. I just don't feel the same way, I guess. So
you've been on a downward trend movie to movie to movie in this this franchise.
I thought the first one, or I thought the second one was the highest rated in her mind.
No, she gave the first one. I think you gave the first one an 8, yeah, and the second one a 7.5, and this one a 7.
I thought you gave.
No, the first one I gave, I'm pretty sure I gave it an 8.5.
I thought she gave the last one
because
an 8.
Then I had given the second one. I gave Ocean's 12 an 8 and changed it to a 7.5.
Oh, that's what that was.
And this one is a 7 now.
All right.
I see.
Okay. Next.
It'll be David with an 8.
Hey.
So, I mean, we all kind of have similar views, and I think maybe mine has something to do with the fact that I was so let down by 2 that I kind of, I guess, same as you, Reese, I didn't really feel excited to watch this one. I didn't want to. And I sat down begrudgingly and played it. And then the first 15 minutes, I was like, okay, this is off to a good start. Still, I was kind of waiting for them to kind of just screw me over with it, I guess. I don't know. I wasn't ready. Maybe I was so low expectations on this that anything would have made me like it more.
Because 12 had a good start. Like,
I think 12 had a pretty good start. So, I don't know. I was kind of waiting for them to mess up. And they didn't really, and I enjoyed what they did throughout the movie. And I don't know if it'll be as memorable later. I don't know. None of these movies technically for me are super memorable, but it does make me look fondly on the first one as well.
Mm-hmm.
And I might come back to this one. I think that this one has more of a better pace, high energy, better end payoff than the rest. And that's why I gave it the highest rating out of the ones I've done so far. I wasn't bored, and I didn't feel confused, and I didn't feel stupid, which is what the second one made me feel.
Fair enough.
And then last but not least, we have AJ with an 8.5.
Hey!
All right.
This is tricky because, I don't know, it's weird being the highest on all this stuff. Like was said, this is a return to form for the franchise, going back to the formula that worked and kind of refining a little bit for Soderbergh. Over especially the problematic second movie. Interestingly enough, we talk about how memorable these movies are and the plots are. And I agree with you. The most memorable movie is still the second one. And I don't know if that's a good thing or not. I do miss the, the female touch of this because I did enjoy the romantic relationship with, you know, the...
Oh, Tess. Yeah.
No. Catherine Zeta-Jones' character.
Yeah.
Isabel.
Isabel.
Yeah, she's the best.
Yeah, so I actually thought she brought something that was needed to the franchise that obviously got overshadowed by other problems in the second movie. And I still find a lot of flaws in this movie. That's why it doesn't get higher than what it is. I did like it better than the first. I just wish Soderbergh, he refined his style, but I feel like he's still too focused on style, especially for a director who's not known for a distinctive style, like, you know, say Snyder's or something like that, who's really got a definite visual signature.
Snyder is that, and probably only that.
Yeah.
I feel like Soderbergh almost wanted that movie to be this at, you know, the expense of some other things like story and flow. And, you know, we tried to, what was good about this movie was it went that more heartwarming, emotional response kind of story with that Robin Hood aspect and payoff. I just wish he touched on some themes. I wish he pushed harder on them, like the whole, you know, your aging analog in a digital world. Like we saw that with the Clair de Lune scene at the Bellagio fountains in the first one, you know, with the orchestral arrangement. Here we get the little digital music box arrangement. And there's like definite opportunities for that just overlooked and focused on other priorities. So yeah, it's an enjoyable movie. It is plagued by kind of that forgettableness. Like it was fun, but I don't remember what happened, you know, a week from now. All I remember is Julia Roberts playing Julia Roberts out of the whole Oceans trilogy. I'm going to stick with 8.5 because, you know, I instantly, after the first movie, re-slipped me a couple bucks and so I dropped my score. So I'm going to blame him on that. I there's still goodwill from the first movie because I feel like I was a little harsh on that, but I still think this movie earned a better score than, you know, the previous two movies, in my opinion, despite the cheesiness, despite the problematic, you know, unrealism of giant drills and all that stuff. Like,
and the lack of female representation.
I was able to suspend my disbelief for the sake of entertainment.
Yeah. Mm. You want to crunch those numbers?
So group average is 7.9.
Hey.
which is the highest of the trilogy. And overall, among our titles we've covered, that puts it below Tropic Thunder, which is at an 8.6, and King Arthur, Legend of the Sword, is below Ocean's 13 with a 7.7. So it kind of fills this gap we've had for a little bit that was like in that 8.5 area where we didn't really touch on. So it fits in nicely.
I'm happy. I'm happy with that.
So question, Reese, do we have somebody who has another opinion on like retroactive opinions on the first movie?
Oh yeah, I was going to call this out earlier. We have a friend who is a little upset with our take or our reviews on Ocean's 11. He's going to call in and give us a brief addition or
a little breakdown.
Another take on, why we're wrong. On Ocean's 11. So we'll insert that here, and we won't be able to respond to it, but that representation will be there for Ocean's 11.
Yeah. Hey, I bet it's a 7. Any of you that feel like we have unjustly criticized this franchise will probably get to enjoy something that's a little more positive.
Hey guys, thank you for the invitation to defend Ocean's 11 for 3 minutes. I don't know that that's enough time to respond to you point by point and tell you why I think you guys are wrong, but I will do my best. So let's get started. First of all, 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, that was a weak joke. Carl Reiner, not Rainer. The fact that you had a problem at the very beginning of the movie does not bode well. Your statement that you don't see Danny's motivation at the beginning, I don't feel like you need to show a character's motivation right when a movie starts. One of the best storytelling techniques is to reveal things throughout the film like a mystery, and I think this movie does that really well. And this is not a movie that is going to spell things out for you. This is a movie where there's about as much nonverbal communication as there is in real life, and if you're waiting for them to tell you things and explain character reactions, then you're just not going to enjoy this movie. But if you pay a lot of attention to the actors' reactions, to their facial expressions, just to their body language in general, I think you're going to get a lot more out of this movie. And I think I see enough of Danny's motivation to rob a casino. And so I had no problem there. The fact that you find George Clooney unlikable, I'm pretty sure you're the only person who doesn't like George Clooney. I'm sure there are other people out there, but I think the reason this movie works so well is because he's oozing charisma. I mean, there's as much charisma from George Clooney as there is subtext in this movie. So if you don't like George Clooney, you're not going to like the movie. I also don't think that making a character an anti-hero is necessarily a bad thing. You're right, if this had been anywhere else but Vegas, these guys would be the villains. I'm pretty sure that Andy Garcia and Matt Damon said that in their in the commentary for Ocean's 11. But yeah, an anti-hero doesn't necessarily make this bad, and when you have George Clooney as your lead, you don't really care. I also don't think this is just because he's butthurt. He's not doing this just to get Tess back. He's doing this because he feels alone. He gets out of the prison, there's no one there. You get to the end of the movie, there's finally Rusty waiting for him. That's the real payoff for George and for... Sorry, that's the real payoff for Danny. Yeah, I couldn't keep going point by point because 3 minutes is up, and I had to stop listening because it was getting really frustrating. So let me just say that I think this is an excellent movie. I think anyone who wants to learn movie making and camera work and how a score can just keep a vibe going should watch this movie. I would give it a 10 subjectively, without hesitation, and objectively, I would hesitate for a moment, and I would still give this a 10.
No, wow, that was interesting opinion. I don't know if I agree with it, but let's move on.
All right, so are we going to do box office?
All right, let's get to critics. Rotten Tomatoes, this movie has a 70%. It's above the second one, below the first, with an audience score of 75%, which is above the second one and below the first. Metacritic score of 62, which is above the second one and below the first, with an audience score of 6.5, and an IMDb score of 6.9, which is above the second and below the first. So,
I wonder how people felt about this movie.
Yeah. So I think a lot of people thought that, oh, this is back to a familiar territory that I like, that I recognize. And it's giving me that warm and cozy Ocean's 11 feel that I got. And I like that. You know, but not as much as the original. But it is definitely better than the laser dance.
Oh, gosh. Oh, yeah. The laser dance.
So, yeah. Overall, good reviews. Not great reviews. It's positive in every category, albeit barely positive. So there's that. I think the first Ocean's movie was in the 80s down to 70s range across the board, and this one's in the 70s to the 60s range. So that gives you any idea. And the second one, I believe, was like 50s across the board. So now you kind of get its place.
Do we know why it was criticized? Like, they were just disappointed they didn't live up to expectations, or it wasn't rewatchable enough, or what?
I don't know specifics. I do think it was generally just maybe some of the criticism was that it was a rehash, maybe undercooked. But I think for the most part, people were pretty positive on it. It's an inoffensive movie. It was probably just like its lack of a reason to exist other than to
6 years
keep
later.
The franchise going.
Yeah, I was going to say, I feel like this type of movie started waning around this time.
Yeah.
So it was kind of pushing something that people weren't exactly looking for again, but there's some familiarity, some sort of good feeling that was left over from the original.
Mm-hmm. So let's move on to our box office game. This movie was released on June 6th of 2007. I am pretty sure it's the first time the franchise has released in the summer. Versus the winter, which I one and two, I believe, were in the winter season.
Yeah, I think December.
Yes. Mm. The budget was dropped down to $85 million. That's probably because Julia Roberts wasn't in it. The last film cost $110 million, and the first one was $85 million, just like this one. So
they had originally intended to have Julia Roberts and Catherine Zeta-Jones in this, but they... changed that idea. Yeah,
their parts were too small,
lines.
And they're like, "I'm not going to sign on for this. All I need to do is say a couple lines." Like,
oh yeah, that's right. They did. They both had a fight.
It's not their fight. Yeah, they say it twice. Like, it's almost like it's
just kind of throwing it at the audience. Like, hey, they're not in this. Okay.
Yeah. So. Yeah. It's just kind of sad. Your two strongest female characters aren't in this movie, and you. It's a kind of a bad look. But
anyway,
that's why we have Ocean's 8.
Yay. Yeah,
exactly. Yay. I feel like that was the...
8 women.
Yeah, that was the correction there. All women. So, guys, worldwide, what did this movie do at the box office? Give me your guesses. I'm going to start with AJ this time.
So what, this was 2007?
In June. Yep.
I will say $350 million.
$350. Noah?
I will go for a cool $370.
370. Arena.
325.
Okay.
300.
300. And our winner is David. Barely. Boom. Just by a hair. Irina, you were very close with 325. Darn. The movie grossed $311 million worldwide. U.S., it did $117 million off of a $36 million opening weekend. That's slightly less than 12, which grossed around $125 million in the U.S., which it's pretty impressive because a summer release, you usually get it dies off quickly after the opening weekend, and this one's opening was very similar to 12's, but it managed to last throughout the summer to make almost as much as 12. So it did very well for itself. In when you add the fact that it cost less than the previous movie, that's another win for this franchise.
I guess they probably saw that, okay, this is kind of slowly dying. I mean, they're still doing well, but...
I don't think that was...
No, actually. I think what Reese was saying is that it actually did just as good as the other
ones. No, well, profit margin-wise, but the second one still had an overall largest... Like, the crowds aren't looking at the budget.
Yeah.
Well, it all
this was a summer movie as opposed
to
the other ones.
I think this franchise still at this point has a lot of life in it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
There's an unfortunate tragedy a year later. Bernie Mac passed away. That kind of put a pin in the franchise, and that kind of was the end of the original lineup. I think George Clooney made some comment about not wanting to return without Bernie Mac element in there. Yeah. So.
Which
and it's probably
beautiful.
Also Steven Soderbergh. He's directed three of these, probably ready to move on to something else.
Like Logan Lucky.
Like Logan Lucky, another heist movie.
Just took him 10 years.
I need to watch that movie. I've heard it's great.
I watched it.
You did?
Mm-hmm.
Is it great?
I wouldn't say great.
Is it a 7?
I would say that it was enjoyable.
Equivalent to maybe a Tomb of the Dragon Emperor?
I would say equivalent to an Ocean's 11.
Okay. But yeah, I think in a different... If Bernie Mac were still with us, I think we might have had maybe one more of these.
Yeah.
I don't know if Soderbergh would have continued on, but I do think the movie made enough to the point where it would justify carrying on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That said, franchise went dormant for a little bit, and we do have a spinoff. It is not the end for this franchise. There's Ocean's 8.
All right.
That will be the movie, obviously, that we talk about next week.
Yeah. So basically, the original is just done. There is no coming back from that one, really. But luckily, we get the next one.
Yeah, we never know.
The spinoff.
Mm-hmm.
We never know, though.
You can find our podcast on all streaming platforms. We're also on Instagram. All right, next week, Ocean's 8. We'll see y'all then.
See you.
Hey, like, comment, and subscribe, boys.
Oh, yeah, that. Please, can rate us on Apple if you really want. If you like us just messing everything up and you enjoy listening to our voices, rate us on Apple Podcasts. Give us 5 stars, please.
Thank you.
Bye.
This is Roman Nagel. If your consciousness absolutely has to intrude upon mine, leave a message.